And oh, this group tonight, God, I pray, Lord, that you will shower down, Lord Jesus, your presence, that we will all be receptive, oh God, to what you want to teach us here tonight. Open our spiritual ears and our spiritual eyes, oh God, oh Father God, and that we, Lord Jesus, would be in one accord to receive what you have for us tonight. Bless our apostle Rahul tonight as he teaches the word of God. Bless the songs here that is going to be sung to us right now. Father, we thank you as we wait in your presence in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Good evening, everyone. Let's worship the Lord tonight. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's nothing worth more that could ever come close. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. I've tasted and seen of the sweetest of loves, where my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome here. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. To be overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence. There's nothing worth more that can ever come from. Nothing can compare. You're our living hope. Your presence, Lord. Oh, I taste it and see of the sweetest of love, when my heart becomes free and my shame is undone. Your presence, Lord. Holy Spirit, you are welcome. Come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for. We overcome by your presence, Lord. Your presence, Lord. More aware of your presence, let's experience the glory of your goodness. Let's become more aware of your presence, let's experience. come flood this place and fill the atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts long for, to be overcome by your presence, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for your presence and for your amazing grace. Hallelujah. Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty and so much stronger? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder? The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphans a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your love, that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. The Lamb who was slain, worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross, you laid down your life, that I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You are my amazing God. Hallelujah. I'm a queen. for the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it on dark Calvary. So I'll cherish the old rugged cross till my trophies at last I lay down. Tonight. We pray that you will be with us as we listen to Apostle Rahul as he ministers to our hearts. Amen.
We want to thank God for this wonderful time. And as those of you who were there for the last meetings, you know that we are talking, or God is speaking to us on the subject of watchmen. And I have covered a lot, but there is still a lot pending about watchmen. Okay, hallelujah. So the last time, to bring to your notice, we saw that the watchman has to have access, has to have access to the third heavens, to the third heaven, where the throne room of God is, where God sits on his throne in the third heaven, the highest of heavens, that is the third heaven. Okay, and the watchman should have access to the third heaven. That means a watchman should have a capacity to wait on the Lord for long, so that he can renew his strength and soar on wings of an eagle, and as an eagle that he would rise in the spirit. We don't physically rise, but our spirit rises. Our bodies are on earth, but we rise in the spirit. With the wings of an eagle, we rise. I told you about the first heaven, about the second heaven. The first heaven, which is the realm of deception and lies. And the prince of the power of the air, that is the prince that rules the first heaven, that is the realm of the air. In the second, after the realm of the air, the first heaven, there is the realm of waters on which Satan rules. The realm of waters, I told you all those things. In the second heaven, there is the realm of waters. That is the realm of warfare. So there are the angels of God, there are the fallen angels, there is a mix there, and there is warfare. And third, I told you, there is a wandering land where people wander. where people wander, where the devil makes them wander round and round and round, so that they should give up and not reach to the gates of the third heaven. But he who has a capacity to wait will rise on high to go through the gates of the third heaven. And when your spirit reaches in third heaven, you don't have to ponder or think that, oh, what I am hearing, is it from God? The presence will be so heavy, you will know that you are in that place that God will just speak to you and reveal to you things that no eye has seen and no ear has heard about your life, about your family, about the root cause of problems in your life, about nations, about cities, about people, about politics, about business, hidden things that no one knows. None of your news channel in the US or Canada will show those things, or none of the politician knows, but God will reveal those secrets to those watchmen. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? The Bible says in Amos chapter number 3 that God does nothing until and unless he reveals his secrets to his servants, the prophets. Who are these prophets? All the prophets are not eligible for that verse. Only those prophets who are in active service with God. Who are in active service with God. There can be 1,000 prophets. There can be 2,000 prophets in the country of US. There can be 10,000 prophets in India. But all the 10,000 prophets who call themselves prophets are not in active service. In other words, they don't have all access to the throne room of heaven. Many of them are prophesying by taking frequency of voices from the first heaven and the second heaven. Even sorcerers do that. I told you, you go to a sorcerer, he will talk like a prophet. He will talk like a prophet. He will tell you which place you stay. He will tell you the name of your husband. He will tell you what your children are going through. He will tell you all those things that you already know. But he will not be able, what he will not be able to reveal to you is the hidden things of God. Is the mystery of God. Because sorcerers and prophets who are operating in flesh and operating in corruption, they will not be able to access the secrets of God. But other things they will say, oh, I see your husband, his hair is white, his face is black, and he will tell you all those things. And people get excited, yes. Oh, these are the things. I don't have people excited when I tell them about word of knowledge, because people know all those things. What a prophet will reveal to you is something that is hidden in the treasury of God that no one knows. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? Sometimes what happens is, sometimes even when you are sitting and you are seeking God in your prayer, you will hear a voice. You will hear a voice that is from God, and it is the voice of God. You will hear a word that is actually from God. But the problem happens to you is you are confused. You are not convicted enough, and you think, is this voice from God, or is this voice from my mind, or is this coming from my imagination? You are confused. You are not able to discern. You know why? Because sometimes when God speaks, it will penetrate, that voice will penetrate through the second heaven and the first heaven. And even if you are in a state of not praying enough, you will hear that voice. But the problem is, you are not convicted enough that it is God speaking to you. Okay? Are we understanding? So what you have to do is, you are building up your spirit man. You are building up your spirit man in the sense you are giving wings to your spirit man to soar on high. And once you start to see God, first day, second day, third day, and once your spirit reaches the heavens of heaven, in the third heaven, the same voice that you heard the first day will become distinctive to you, and you will know it was the voice of God. Now I am convicted that it was not this voice, not that voice, not coming from there. It was the voice of God, but it becomes distinctive to you. Are we understanding, people of God? Hallelujah. Yes, God speaks. What did Jesus say? Mary has chosen the good part to listen to me. To listen to me. Hallelujah. Many times when you are in the storms of your life and God speaks to you, but in that storm you are not able to discern, oh, you will think whether, which, I don't know, is it the voice of God or not? You hear the word, but you are not able to discern, is it the voice of God or not? That's why the formula of the Spirit, that is called the secret place, is given to us. We go in the secret place to discern the voice we have heard. And when we rise in the Spirit, are we understanding? You have to build up your spirit, man, that you need to make a distinction between the voice of God and the voice of your mind, or the voice coming from your human spirit. There will become a distinction. There will come a distinction. Hallelujah. But God is speaking to his people. God is speaking to his people. But those who wait on the Lord, they are the one. That's why you can have a word of God, but you will not say it. You know why? Because you are unsure about it. For you to teach with conviction, for you to prophesy with conviction, for you to preach with conviction the gospel, you have to bring the words from the third heaven. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? Some people are teaching, but there is no conviction. No conviction. Spirit of conviction is not there. Apostle Paul says, we brought the gospel to you in the book of Thessalonians. He says, the gospel came to you in the Holy Spirit, in power and in conviction. In conviction. You know why? Because the gospel that apostle was preaching, Jesus himself gave it to him. Galatians chapter 1, you will see there, that he went to the desert of Arabia, and there he had encounters for around 3 years. Hallelujah. He was with God. He was with God. Those people who preach on the surface, though they are shouting, though they are trying to be convicting, but actually it's not convicting. The spirit of conviction that the Holy Spirit brings in is not there, because they are preaching something that they are not sure about. They are teaching something that they are not sure about. Until I am sure, until I have received things from God, and God, the spirit man has verified it is from God, I cannot preach through conviction. Hallelujah, hallelujah. The man who is with God, hallelujah, his words will be different. That is what the people of Israel told. This Jesus is different. He teaches with authority. His teachings are different. He teaches with authority. You see that? Hallelujah. There was something in his voice that the Pharisees did not add. Jesus Christ, when he taught, even the Pharisees were teaching. But when Jesus started his teaching ministry, the people who heard Jesus, they said, this man is different, because whatever he teaches comes with authority. Comes with authority, comes with conviction. That means this man knows what he is teaching. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? So you got to build your spirit man. You got to build your spirit man to access the third heavens. And many of the things you will realize that God had been speaking to you from 2 years, but you were not able to make a distinction that it was God. And now you know that voice that was coming to you, God was trying to speak to you. But now when you have rose up into intimacy with God, I told you the meaning of intimacy with God is not hugging Jesus or kissing Jesus or Jesus carrying you in the pictures that you receive on WhatsApp or Facebook. It's not like that. The meaning of intimacy is in the throne room of God, being in the throne room of God, in the most holy place, accessing that place where God sits. Hallelujah. Amen. I told you that when Moses started his ministry, because he was too busy in his domestic life, serving his father-in-law, Jethro, in the land of Midian, there was a 30 years delay in the deliverance of the children of Israel from the land of Egypt. 30 years delay they faced. Why? Because Moses was not able to access the throne room of God. That's why God came into a burning bush and spoke to Moses, because Moses was not rising on high. God had to come down. And when even you see Listen to me carefully. When God was speaking to Moses through the burning bush, God was speaking to him, the Lord of heaven and earth, God of Abraham, Isaac and Jacob. But yet, those words were not convicting Moses because his spirit was not prepared. You know, he was doubting. He said, God, I don't want to go. God, if I go there, if they ask me what I will do, on all sorts of those questions were coming on. Are you understanding? So the words of God, Moses was not getting convicted about the words of God because his spirit man was not prepared. Moses was trained as he started to obey the call of God. God started to train Moses. And then you will see after that, God gave him the laws, God gave him the ordinances. That time he never questioned God. God gave him the measurements for the tabernacle to be built. He never questioned God because now his spirit man was equipped. Are we understanding? So my dear friends, God would speak to you. God will speak to you. But because your spirit man is, your flesh is so mighty, you will start to question God. You will start to teach God instead of receiving teaching from him. And all sorts of things. You will start to do those things with God. Are we understanding? Hallelujah. Watchman. Watchman has to have access to the throne room of God. Because on the everyone has to have access. Every believer. But watchman especially, because the watchman has to catch the announcement that God makes in heaven. And bring to the people. To warn them. To correct them. To make the trumpet sound, to blow the trumpet, because on the basis of his assignment, he has to have access. Without having access to heaven, he cannot operate in his responsibility to be a watchman. Hallelujah. Okay? Hallelujah. So let us continue. What we are going to see tonight is that watchmen are intercessors. Watchmen are intercessors. Watchmen are intercessors. Write it down. Okay? Now what we are talking about, watchmen, intercession, spiritual warfare, prayer, these are the functions of a prophet actually. These are the functions of a prophet. And a prophet operating in his full anointing and the full measure of God's call will be a watchman, will be an intercessor, will be into spiritual warfare and will be too much into prayer and seeking God. Because the prophetic office assigned on the body of Christ, I have spoken a lot about the prophetic office. It's not to tell the names of people. Your name is this, your village is this, your native place is this. No, not those things. Actually, not those things. Though that is the gift of the word of knowledge that every believer can operate in. That is not the prophetic office. A prophetic office is given to the body of Christ in a hierarchy to teach and train the believer's hands for war in spiritual warfare. That is why prophets are there. They teach and train. I will come to the scriptures. Okay, but listen to me. The prophets train and teach the believer's hands for war in spiritual warfare. They reveal the heart of God to his people. To the people of God, reveal the heart of God, reveal the announcement that God makes. That is the watchman office. Blow the trumpets, warn the people of what is going to happen. A prophet is sold out, is a bond servant to the Lord God Most High. Hallelujah. And especially what is missing in the body of Christ is There is not this prophetic ministry, real prophetic ministry, where believers are trained to fight the battle. Because as soon as you become a Christian, you are in a battlefield. And Apostle Paul says, your wrestle is not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against rulers of darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. So put on the whole armor of God. And then he goes on to speak about the armor of God. Hallelujah. So he is saying that every believer, as soon as you accept Christ, is in a state of warfare, because you are the first member that accepted Jesus from your family. Those spirits that used to hold generations before your generations, 20, 30 generations before you, The line of generations were held by those demons, and you come out first and accept the lordship of another God, that is Jesus Christ, and leave their lordship. Those are the demons which will attack you. Hallelujah. Because these spirits are jealous spirits. One of the characteristics of a spirit is that they are jealous. They don't want anyone going out of their lordship. Once you go out of their lordship, you accept Jesus Christ, you think that life will be wonderful. You think that the evangelist who preached to you told you, oh, come to Jesus, you will have a lot of money. God will do this for you. God will give you a car. But you will see when you accept Jesus Christ, oh my God, those attacks will start to manifest in your life. And you know what is happening. You don't know what is happening to you. You don't know. You are into a battlefield. You have turned your face against the spirits by accepting Jesus Christ. You get into warfare. So we need prophets who can train the hands of believers. Believers who are at different levels of their walk with God. To train them to take the nations. To train them how to combat with the forces of darkness. To train them in understanding of spiritual warfare. Are we understanding till now, people of God? Hallelujah. So I told you that prophetic office having watchmen, intercessors, spiritual warfare and prayer. And these are the job of a prophet. And watchmen are also intercessors. The person who has access to the throne room of God is also having an intercessory gift. Intercessors. Because God will pronounce a judgment, he will hear it. He can negotiate with God and ask God. Hallelujah. Why does God pronounce his judgment? God is a loving God. God is a merciful God. But why does God pronounces a judgment upon a nation, upon people, upon a person? Why? You know why? Because there is an accuser who brings accusations to God on the basis of legal terms in the heavenly courts, in the throne room of God. Hallelujah. That is what, listen to me now. We are coming. I have taught you about intercession a lot. But I am going to teach you tonight in context of what we are speaking about watchmen. That watchmen are intercessors. Stay with me. Stay with me. That is what was happening with Job. Satan came in front of God and he told, you know, Job loves you. Job worships you because you have blessed him. If you take away those things from him, he will curse you. You see that? Why does God do some things? Because there is an accuser. There is an accuser that brings accusations against the people of God. Not only against the people of God, but also against the nations. He brings accusations. And that too on the basis of legal terms. The day you start to grow in the Lord, and God is about to give you ministry, and you know, oh, God has chosen me for ministry, but you are not able to, you are starting off your ministry, but you are not able to do nothing in ministry. You are getting persecuted. People are not listening to you. There are attacks from left, right and center. You don't know why those things are happening. You are doing everything correct. You are preaching from the Bible. Your heart is right. You don't know who is stopping you. What is wrong? Why your ministry is not growing? Because in the throne room of God, listen to me, in the throne room of God, the accuser of the brethren brings records that your father had killed people and shed the blood of innocent people. So on the basis of the legal terms in the courts of heaven, you are not eligible to do these things. And he launches attacks. Oh, everything that I am saying is in the scripture. I hope I come to those things. So stay with me, okay? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Everything that I am saying, the evidence is there in the scripture. I am just giving you introduction of what we are going through. So are you understanding the reason why God judges, releases a judgment, releases a punishment? Because there is an accuser. So who is an intercessor? Write it down. Intercessor is a lawyer in the spirit. Who is he? Intercessor is a lawyer in the spirit who pleads the case of individuals, families, churches, and nations before the righteous judge. Intercessor is a lawyer in the spirit who pleads the case of individuals, families, churches, and nations before the righteous judge. The opposition lawyer is Satan. The opposition lawyer is Satan, who accuses people to God on the basis of legal and lawful terms of heaven. Yes, that's why Satan knows the Bible. He knows the laws of the spirit more than any other nominal Christian. He knows it. And on the basis of those things, he will bring records, because Satan records. Okay, hallelujah. You came to Jesus. You accepted Jesus. You said, Lord, you forgive my sins. You forgive my sins, but you forgot to ask forgiveness and be cleansed and thoroughly repent of one of your sin, a sin where you slept and committed fornication with a girl before you came to Christ. You did not repent of it. When you start growing in the Lord, that record, that case in your record files that Satan has, Satan will bring it to the Lord and he will accuse you, because some things are not settled in the spirit. Are we understanding? Some things are, so Satan is a lawyer that accuses people. Now to who will fight with this lawyer? If there is no lawyer, but thank God, God has given the ministry of intercession, where intercessors plead the case, and they are the lawyers that fight Satan. They are the lawyers that will fight. Oh, no, this not. Oh, he did this, but this is what he did, and he pleaded the blood of Jesus. As per the legal terms of heaven, the blood breaks every curse, so your case is not valid. So there, are you understanding? There is an argument between the lawyers in the courts of heaven. An intercessor is a lawyer. Hallelujah. Amen. Intercessor is a lawyer. And these are the things that I am talking in context to watchmen. Watchmen have to do those things. I will tell you. I will take you when I take you into the scripture. But understand the concept. The intercessor is a lawyer in the spirit who will plead the cases of people, individual, families, churches, nations before the righteous judge. Now, secondly, is this judge, the Lord of heaven and earth, the righteous judge, the sovereign Lord. This judge, his heart is not to pass judgment on his people. His heart is to pass a judgment in the favor of his people. But actually, because of Satan, who brings legal term records on the basis of legal terms, because he is your God at the same time he's a righteous judge. He's the sovereign ruler of heaven and earth. He's a just God, so he has to execute justice. So since Satan, the accuser, brings some things which are facts that cannot be ignored about a person, about a nation, and on the basis of that, he has to judge. But in his heart, he is a merciful God. He is a loving God, and he wants to do and pass a judgment in favor of his people. But he cannot do it because Satan accuses people on the basis of legal terms, brings case against the people of God. So the role of an intercessor is to combat against the intelligence of Satan, is to combat against the knowledge and the terms that he is bringing to accuse people. So this lawyer called the intercessor has to be fully trained and has to be expert in the judicial laws of the spirit and in the revelation of the word of God, and he should himself abide by the laws. Are we understanding? A intercessor that is a lawyer has to be fully trained and has to be an expert of the judicial laws of the spirit, has to be equipped and thoroughly grounded in the revelations of the word of God. Not enough to gain knowledge. Oh, this verse is this verse. You have to have the revelation, the mystery from the word of God through which you can fight cases. Fight the case for your life. Fight the case for your family. Then fight the case for your nation. Hallelujah. You have to be thoroughly trained in the laws of the spirit. A lawyer who is not trained, the accuser will bring those records. You will not have any answer to how to combat. You need to be thoroughly equipped in the spirit of the Lord. And yourself abide by the laws of God for you to fight the case. Fight the case set before the Lord that the devil has brought up. Are we understanding? Okay. Let's go to Ezekiel chapter number 22. Ezekiel chapter number 22, verse number 30. Anyone knows that verse? Come on, intercessors. Ezekiel 22 verse 30. It says, "So I sought for a man among them who would make a wall and stand in the gap before me on behalf of the land." That means a lawyer who represents a nation. Are you understanding? Who stands in the gap before me on behalf of the land, that I should not destroy it. But I found no one, therefore I have poured out my indignation on them. I have consumed them with the fire of my wrath, and I have recompensed their deeds on their own heads, says the Lord God. Are you understanding the meaning of it? The Lord was searching for a lawyer who can fight the case set before him. But there was no lawyer who stood as a representative for the nation of Israel on behalf of the land. So that since there was no lawyer representing a nation, God had to accept the case that was brought before him and release the judgment on the land. Amen. Can I have an amen? If you are with me, remove your mute and say amen. Are you understanding?
Amen.
Amen. Okay. Hallelujah. I pray that the Holy Spirit will give you understanding of what I am speaking. Okay. Listen to me carefully. Yes, that is the verse about an intercessor. God sought for a man who can stand on behalf of the land. That means God needs representatives for nations in the courts of heaven. Listen to me very carefully. In the nation of India, it is how much ever mission work is going on in the nation of India. Missionaries are coming, preaching the gospel. There are prophets, there are apostles, pastors, planting churches. Revival crusades are happening. Healing crusades are happening. This and that is happening. But still, in spite of such a lot of ministry work on the fields of India, still the destiny of India lies in the hand of Satan. You know why? Because there is no one in the courts of heaven to represent India. Hallelujah. I was in the Sunday service here in India when I was taking the church service, and the Lord told me, Rahul, there is no one for India that can represent this nation. And I said, Lord, forgive us. Hallelujah. People think, oh, revival crusades are going. Healing crusades are happening. Revival is in America. Revival is in Canada. Revival, and we are planting churches. We are preaching the gospel. But the destiny of that nation still lies in the hands of Satan, because there is no one, no lawyer that could represent that nation in the courts of heaven. Everyone is busy on the fields of ministry, but no one is in the courts of heaven to represent USA, to represent Canada, to represent Kenya, to represent Pakistan, to represent Nigeria. God wants intercessors who can stand in the courts of heaven to represent a nation, so that Satan's case can be nullified. Yes, that's why I am not overtaken by this is happening, that is happening. What the Lord is looking for is, can anyone stand before me on behalf of the nation? Is there a representative for USA? Is there a representative in before me for Canada, who can negotiate with me and who can nullify the accusation for Canada that has been brought before me by Satan? Hallelujah. 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 Oh my. Yes, this is what I have written. How much ever number of missionaries are there in a nation preaching the gospel, or pastors, apostles planting churches, doing crusades, doing revival meetings, does not bring the destiny in God's hands until there are people on behalf of the nation to represent the nation in God's throne room. In God's throne room, we need watchmen. We need watchmen who can represent nations in God's throne room. People of God, let me give you advice. Let me give you advice. Ministers, pastors, don't get too busy in ministry. Don't get too busy in ministry. Plead for your nation. Plead for your nation. Seek. Don't be happy by planting a church of 100 people. It's not enough. God's heart is for the nations. And a nation can be saved only when there are people who stand there fighting the case for that nation. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Once I was praying, I started in the morning. I prayed. It was afternoon. And when it was afternoon, I was feeling sleepy. So my eyes was closing like this. And the map of India was before me. And I was praying. My eyes was closing like this in the afternoon. As soon as, you know, because of the sleepiness, my conscious shut off, a spirit appeared before me. And that spirit told me, I hold India captive under me. And the spirit looked at me angrily. Oh my. Hallelujah. Ask of me the nations, says the Lord, and I will give it to you. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? The Lord said, I sought for a man who would make a wall and stand in the gap on behalf of the nation before me, but I found no one. That's why I destroyed them. God needs a representative for the nation. God needs a representative for your family who can plead the case for your family in the court of heaven. Hallelujah. People, listen to me. First of all, don't go out to preach the gospel. Pray for your family. Your family is not saved. Your family is dominated by demonic forces and forces of darkness. And you want to do big ministry. Even if you start to do big ministry, after 3 years, the spirits from your family will attack you and attack your ministry. Sort the cases out step by step. Be a intercessor. Be a lawyer for your family. Search out what are the legal cases that are brought by the accuser against your family. And develop and make your spirit mighty to fight those cases. Hallelujah. The destiny of nations can be in the hands of God when there is a representative, a lawyer in the throne room of God who pleads the case for the nation and defeats the opposition lawyer, that is Satan, who brings accusation against that nation. Hallelujah. For your information, Romans chapter number 8, verse number 34, where it says that Jesus is at the right hand of God, doing the job of a chief lawyer, fighting cases that Satan brings to God against people. Romans 8, chapter number 34. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Romans 8, chapter number 34. Who is he who condemns? It is Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Now you know the meaning of it. He is the chief lawyer. He is the chief lawyer. Jesus is the chief lawyer at the right hand of God, pleading the cases brought against his people, brought against nations by Satan. You know how he pleads the case? By the evidence of his own blood that he shed for the people, for the nations. Yes, by the evidence of his own blood, he pleads the cases. You know how many times Satan goes to God to accuse you? especially servants of God, whom God wants to use. And God says, I want to use my son like this. And then, before he wants to use you, I will come to the scripture. That has happened in the scripture very clearly. Before he wants to use you, Satan will bring a case to God that is valid on the basis of the legal terms of heaven. And you start to do, you will think, oh God, you have heard the voice of God. You started to do it, but it is not prospering because there is a case being brought against you. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? Are we understanding? I saw the news about Pakistan recently. And there is a lot of, there is a rise, maybe emergence of a civil war that is happening in Pakistan. You know why? Because the prime minister is been dethroned. The previous prime minister is been dethroned on the basis of legal terms that he has violated. On the basis of corruption, he was dethroned. And the person who is working to dethrone, who has already dethroned him, and now who is working to do some things against the previous prime minister, is the current prime minister. And the current prime minister is the brother of the first prime minister, the prime minister who was before this prime minister. So he is taking revenge for his brother, and all those things are going on in the news. I'm just telling you. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Because you rejected the lordship of Satan and accepted Jesus in your life, he wants to take a revenge on you. And he does not want you to prosper in this kingdom. Are we understanding? A spirit of jealousy, a spirit of revenge is on you. Because you have ministers who grow in the Lord, because through your prayers, nations are delivered, Satan is not happy with you. He will search out the files to bring cases against you so that he can hinder you. Hallelujah. Are we understanding? Are we understanding? We need lawyers. We need lawyers in the throne room of God who can plead the cases. Who can plead the cases. Okay, hallelujah. The Bible records scriptures where it shows that Satan brings accusation or makes people sin against God to break his word and break his laws and become victims of his judgment. And we need lawyers in the spirit to plead that case. So let us go into the scripture. Let us go into the scripture. Listen to me. One of the things Satan will do is, if he wants to, if there are no cases against you, in everything, every case has been washed away by the blood of Christ. Okay? What he will do, it's not the end. You have not got the complete victory over Satan. What he will start to do is, he will come to you to entice, he will target your weak points, and he will entice you to fall into a sin against the Lord. So because you sin against the Lord, because of that sin, God's face will be turned against you. That is another thing that Satan does. To nations he does that. He does that to the nations. We will see that. Let's go to Exodus chapter number 32, verse number 7 to 14. Exodus chapter number 32, verse number 7 to 14. And the Lord said to Moses, go, get down, for your people whom you brought out of the land of Egypt have corrupted themselves. They have turned aside quickly out of the way which I commanded them. They have made themselves a molded calf and worshipped it and sacrificed to it, and said, this is your God, O Israel, that brought you out of the land of Egypt. Oh my. See what they have done, Moses. See what they have done. The spirit of Egypt, because the golden calf was an idol that people used to worship in Egypt. That was the same spirit that overtook Aaron. And I don't have time to show you. When the gold was brought to Aaron, did anyone tell him to carve an image that looks like that? No, he did not have idea which image to carve. But the image, the idol he carved out of it was a golden calf. Where did he get that idea from? A spirit from Egypt gave him the instruction to carve that golden image of the calf. Are we understanding? Satan provoked and Satan made Aaron and whole Israel fall into a grave sin of idol worship. Because Satan knew that if they will sin against God, God will arise and destroy and kill all those people. And my job will be done. Even though they came out of Egypt, but they were not able to reach the promised land. Are we understanding, people of God? Satan wants to make a group of people or nation fall into a sin so that God's face will be turned against them. Stay with me. Now, verse number 9. And the Lord said to Moses, I have seen this people, and indeed it is a stiff-necked people. Now therefore, let me alone that my wrath may burn hot against them, and I may consume them, and I will make of you a great nation. The Lord his God, make nation. Then Moses pleaded with the Lord his God. Pleaded, underline. He is a lawyer. You see that? He is pleading the case now. How he is pleading? He pleaded. Then Moses pleaded with the Lord his God and said, Now look at me. Now imagine God sitting on the throne and a case brought to God which is against the people of Israel. On the basis of the commandment of God that they have worshipped idol, they should die there. They should be killed. That is the case of Satan. That is the opposition lawyer, that is Satan. Okay? Now the intercessor, who is a lawyer in the spirit for the people of God, see how he pleads the case. On what terms? Because what has come? If God destroys the people of Israel, God will still be righteous, because he has destroyed the people of Israel on the basis of a legal term of heaven, because they have worshipped the idol and they have rejected the lordship of Jehovah God. So God is just if he destroys and kills them. Are we together? But how can a lawyer plead the case and stop God from not destroying the people? See how he pleads the case. The Lord is God, and the Lord pleaded with the Lord his God and said, Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you have brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians speak and say, he brought them out to harm them, to kill them in the mountains, and to consume them from the face of the earth? Turn from your fierce wrath and relent from this harm to your people. Hallelujah. First point that this lawyer brings to God is the glory and the name of God should not be blasphemed among the Gentiles if this happens. That is the first point that this lawyer brings. Do you see that? Now, what is the next one? Verse number 13. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, to whom you swore by your own self and said to them, I will multiply your descendants as the stars of heaven, and all this land that I have spoken of, I give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever. The second point he brought is a covenant that the Lord had made with their forefathers. A legal covenant, an agreement that was signed and stamped by heaven. A promise of God that the lawyer brought before God. On the basis of these two points, verse number 14 says, so the Lord relented from the harm which he said he would do to his people. Hallelujah. 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 We need lawyers. We need lawyers who can represent nations. We need lawyers who can represent families, who can represent. I told you, this lawyer who is also a watchman, He can speak like that to God because he has a throne position with God. Hallelujah. We need people who can rise up to that level of intercession and the watchman ministry, by whose prayer, hallelujah, Satan's case, however powerful and strong it is, can be nullified. You see how God is? God's nature is that he is a just God. So if Satan brings the case, if Satan would have brought the case, they have worshipped idols, on the basis of this command, you have to kill these people, destroy them. And if there is no one on behalf of the nation standing before God to plead the case in the court of heaven, the judgment will be passed in the favor of Satan. And the judgment will be passed against. You see the importance of the role of intercession? Hallelujah. Nations are destroyed. Nations are calamity. You know why that is? It's happening with Pakistan? Because there is no one from Pakistan who stands in the courts of heaven. No one, I tell you. I know people, I know nations, I know nations who have representatives in heaven. But Pakistan is in jeopardy. Yes. And soon India will be, if we don't have intercessors. If we don't have intercessors. The mindset of the ministers of the gospel in Pakistan, India, is feed the poor, do this ministry, do that ministry, plant churches. But who will represent the nation? Do whatever you want. How much ever revival comes, crusades happen, healing crusades happen. But if there is no one to represent the nation, the destiny of that nation will be destroyed by Satan. It's in the hands of Satan. Satan will do what he wants to do in that nation. Hallelujah. Your family is suffering. Your family is in jeopardy. And you are, oh, I want to preach the gospel. I want to do that. I want to go there. I want to go to that place. And your family is suffering. Your own married relationship is not in the right place. Leave that ministry and go and seek God. Go and seek God. Hallelujah. Because there is, when you are doing ministry and casting out demons there, healing people, Satan is building up your case here. He's putting files after files after files before God.
Thanks, Lord.
Hallelujah. Amen. Are we understanding, people?
Thanks, Lord.
Amen. Amen. Yes. Oh my. Oh my. And see how he intercedes. The points that he brings. He's an expert. He remembers the covenants that God made, on the basis of which it's in God's heart that he does not, because the Bible says God does not want anyone to perish, but everyone to be saved. But is there a man who can negotiate with God? Is there a man who can plead the case? Hallelujah. Otherwise, God, as a just God, has to pass the judgment in the favor of the accuser who accuses the brethren. Hallelujah. That is the way of the justice system of heaven. That there needs to be a lawyer who is called an intercessor, who can plead the case for the nation. Who can plead the case for the nation. Okay, let me take you to Genesis chapter number 6. Okay, I want to bring to your notice, people of God, stay very alert and sensitive to what I am speaking. I want to bring to your notice that whenever the population on this earth goes beyond a limit that Satan has set, Satan devises plans to depopulate the earth. When Adam created God, the first commandments he gave to Adam was dominate and multiply on the face of the earth. Multiply. When Noah came out of the ark, see the commandments God gave to Noah. Multiply, subdue the earth. Multiplication is the plan of God. And all this news that you hear on your TV saying, oh, if the population grows beyond this, we will not have oxygen to breathe. If the population will grow beyond this limit, we will not have food. People will go hungry. So the population needs to be controlled. It's a lie. It's a lie of the enemy. That is a lie. The earth is existent from so many years, and the God has created the earth in such a way that even After generations after generation after generation after us, the earth has the resources to feed them. But it's a lie that the devil says, oh, gives through the news, oh, population is increasing, so this will happen, that will happen. Oh, we are the humans who are destroying the planet Earth. We need to decrease and people need to decrease and depopulate, and all those things are satanic agenda. Depopulation is not a godly agenda. It's not come from the wisdom of heaven. It's a satanic agenda. Hallelujah. Through news, they are putting fear in the hearts of people. So couples are afraid to give birth to children. Yes, that is happening in the advertisements. Be careful how many children you have, because the cost of living will increase, the cost of education will increase, children will be a burden on you. It is not so. It is not so. Hallelujah. You can give birth to children. And if you are a Christian, God, how much ever children you give birth to, 2, 3, 4, God will take care of them. And let me give you a disclaimer, by one wife, okay? By one wife. Hallelujah. Otherwise, people will misunderstand this and they will say, oh, Apostle Rahul say give birth to children, and they will misunderstand. So, with your own wife. Hallelujah. Okay. Listen to me. What I was saying is, anytime the population crosses on the earth beyond a certain limit, Satan and his army is on high alert to carry out a certain agenda so that they can depopulate the earth. The number one agenda on their list is to make the people filled with demons and so sinful against God that God will be provoked to anger to destroy the people. That is the number one agenda of on his list. That is what happened in Genesis chapter number 6. Let me read that to you. Genesis chapter number 6. Stay with me. Okay. Genesis chapter number 6. Now it came to pass when men began to multiply on the face of the earth. Multiplication. They became to increase. They started to increase. Daughters were born to them, that the sons of God saw the daughters of men. The sons of God, actually it's translated from the original script as fallen angels, saw the daughters of men, that they, I can teach you on the daughters of men, but I don't have time. They came, descended from a woman called Nama. Okay, I don't have time for those things. They attracted demons to sleep with them. They attracted fallen angels to sleep with them. They were not good daughters of men, you know, godly daughters. By that beauty, they used to attract fallen angels to have sex with them. Okay, any which ways, I am not going into that. It's a huge topic, but let us go ahead. That they were beautiful, the sons of God, the fallen angels saw the daughters of men were beautiful, and they took wives for themselves of all whom they chose. And the Lord said, my spirit shall not strive with man forever, for he is indeed flesh, yet his days shall be 120 years. So immediately when they started to have marriage and sex, God's spirit was grieved against mankind. Let us read ahead. There were giants on the earth in those days, and also afterwards when the sons of God came into the daughters of men and they bore children to them. Those were the mighty men who were of old, men of renown. When they had sex, they gave birth to half woman and to half man and half beast. Half man and half beast, having demonic powers. Okay, listen to me. When a fallen angel, okay, listen to me. Okay, the birthing process is from God. God told mankind to multiply. Is that what the Bible says? Okay. God, because Adam was alone, God made Eve so that they can have sex in the covenant of marriage and they can give birth to children. Hallelujah. When a child is born in the physical flesh and blood, along with the child, a spirit is born. A spirit is born. Are we understanding? Because it is the spirit in a body of clay that gives life to the body. Okay? It is the spirit that gives life. A spirit is born. along with the, because man is made of body, soul and spirit. Even the believers have a spirit, but the human spirit. Okay, it is the spirit that gives life. Okay, listen to me. That is the birthing process. A baby is born along with the baby. Understand, there are spirits, there is a spirit born. So in the same way, what the fallen angels were doing on the face of the earth was, by having sex with women on the earth, they were giving birth to demonic spirits. Fallen angels are different, and a demonic spirit, a demon is different. Demonic spirits started to multiply on the face of the earth in satanic rituals. They will have, Satan will have people sleep before him and have sex. And when what you called that small baby is in the birthing process, that part of the baby, I forgot scientifically. Something they call it. Can anyone
embryo.
Help? Embryo. Embryo is born. Embryo is created in the womb of a, what Satan demands is, bring out the embryo and cut the embryo and sacrifice the blood. Because the agenda of Satan, a spirit is released. A demonic spirit. So see that what I'm saying, see that in the scripture. Okay, verse number 5, after they had having sex, they came together and mighty men were born through the sex. What also happened in verse 5 is, then the Lord saw that the wickedness of man was great in the earth. How the wickedness of man became great? And that every intent of the thoughts of his heart was only evil continually. What started to happen to men is how they became wicked, because every man started to think evil continually. No man will think evil just like that. There is a demonic spirit that enters a man, that they start to think evil by the mind of that demonic spirit. That signifies that the fallen angels and the women of the earth have, by their sexual relationships, there was an increase in the number of demons. There was an increase in the number of demonic spirits that started to go around the face of the earth and started to possess the minds of people, to make them think evil, to make them think wickedly against God. Are we together, people? Okay, hallelujah. And the Lord was sorry that he made man on earth, and he was grieved in his heart. Oh my. Hallelujah. You see, Satan saw, first of all, the first verse says, when men started to multiply on earth, Satan started to carry out this certain activity of releasing his fallen angels to sleep with women, and they slept with women, and you know what happened? Wickedness increased after they had sex. Wickedness increased after they had sex. The sin of adultery is a dangerous sin. Yes. After you have sex with a woman outside of the marriage of your of the marriage covenant, who is not your wife, oh my, spirits will be released through that sexual relationship. You don't know, when you have sex outside the covenant of God, you are giving birth to demons in your life and demons in the life of the lady or the woman you are having sex with. Hallelujah. On top of that, I would say that even if you imagine a woman in your mind lustfully, you have already committed adultery. Do you know the meaning of that verse? Do you know the meaning of the verse? The meaning of the verse is, if there is a certain woman you are imagining sexually in your mind, actually you are bewitching the woman. And what will happen to that woman? Listen to me. I am talking things that I have handled in prayer, cases that I have handled in prayer. I know what happens. When you will imagine that woman sexually in your mind, you are bewitching that woman in the spirit, who is not your wife. Bewitching that woman in the spirit. What will happen? When night will come and the woman will go to sleep, the woman will see you in her dream. See you in her dream. Trying to have sex with her or touching her inappropriately. So when you imagine, a demonic spirit had you imagine that woman, and then because that demonic spirit does does wants, he, the intention of the demonic spirit is to, in the physical realm, in reality, to bring you both together to commit adultery. So he will also, by your bewitchment, imagination, he will put thoughts in the woman's head in the night when she sleeps, by bringing you in the woman's dreams, and that you are touching her inappropriately or having sex with her. And the woman will have the dream and she will get up. And as soon as they have a sexual dream, there is a seed sown in the body of attraction. And the woman will start thinking about you. That is what happens in the realms of the spirit. Masturbation is demonic. Many pastors are teaching, oh, you can masturbate if you want to satisfy yourself. It's demonic, because if you have to masturbate, you have to imagine something that can give you that arousal, in sexual arousal. Oh my. Hallelujah. And the woman or the girl you will think about, you are bewitching the girl. You are bewitching the woman. Same for woman. If you think lustfully about a man, you are bewitching. And what will happen? You will get dreams about the man. I have handled cases like that, where ladies call me and tell me, oh, you know, I am not talking to that pastor, but the pastor every day is coming in my dream to have sex with me. Oh, they are sexual predators. I have handled cases. Elderly ladies, 40 years, 50 years, 60 years, they have called me. Hallelujah. They have not given that information to any other, but they have called me to discuss those cases. And then I found out, this is the trouble. Oh my God. Hallelujah. As soon as a sexual relation happens, as soon as you listen to the devil for 5 minutes, 2 minutes, 3 minute pleasure, you sleep with the woman, both of you come together, after that there is a relay race of demons that start to happen in your life, in your family, relay race of demons. Many marriages are not coming together. People call me, oh, my wife is not coming to me. And what I see in the spirit for them is, this man who wants me to pray for his wife has slept with a woman and not repented. Oh, hallelujah. Sexual relationship gives birth to disaster. After they had sex, the fallen angels and the daughters of God had sex. What started to happen there is the men became continually evil. A release of demonic spirits was released on the face of the earth. Men started to think evil continually and do evil continually. And God was grieved. And Satan's agenda was fulfilled, that God said, now I have to destroy this mankind completely, depopulate the earth. Are we understanding? But the good news is, he found Noah. And through Noah, because Noah was righteous as per that generation, I have explained you a lot about Noah. And God destroyed the whole earth by the process of flood. Everyone say the process of flood. The destruction of mankind by flood is a spiritual process. Is a spiritual process. You have to understand that. Okay? It's a what? Spiritual process. When you will see the Hebrew script, and God says that I will never again destroy the earth, this its creatures, the mankind, with flood or with water again, you will understand that that script actually signifies that God was in a kind of a habit of, whenever mankind sins, he wants to destroy the mankind with flood. And the process of flood is a process in which the process is, only the human beings will be destroyed, but Satan will not be destroyed. Are you understanding? Satan will not be destroyed. So when God, I don't have time to go into the scriptures, let me go a little fast now. So when you will read Genesis chapter 9, where God makes a covenant with Noah, you know what is the covenant? The covenant is that I will remember this covenant and I will not destroy all flesh with water again. He is saying there that never again I will bring a judgment on the face of the earth that will only punish the mankind. That is what he is saying. But this time, I will change this process. I will never again only destroy the mankind. But this time, hallelujah, the process of judgment will be that along with the people who have collaborated with Satan, I will destroy the destroyer himself, who is the main culprit.
Hallelujah.
Who is the main culprit? That is the meaning of it. That is the covenant. That is what the covenant signifies. See, what was the covenant sign? The covenant sign was a rainbow in the cloud. The rainbow in the cloud is actually a big angel that is recording that covenant. Stay with me. The rainbow in the cloud is actually a huge angel that is recording the covenant. This angel is used by God whenever God makes a covenant with earth and with people, with his servants. This covenant, remember when people of Israel were coming out of Egypt and the Red Sea had to be parted and Egyptians were going to kill Israel? What came there? A pillar of cloud and a pillar of fire. This angel has one leg of cloud and one leg of fire. He's the angel of the covenant, and the covenant which was made with Abraham, that God will rescue the people, the descendants, out of the land of bondage. This angel appeared in the middle of Egypt and the people of Israel executing the covenant and protecting them. This angel again appears in Revelation chapter number 10. This angel again appears in Revelation chapter number 10. Come with me to Revelation chapter number 10. It will blow your mind. Hallelujah. Revelation chapter number 10. I saw, verse number 1. I saw still another mighty angel coming down from heaven, clothed with a cloud, and a rainbow was on his head. Cloud, rainbow, and his face was like the sun, and his feet like the pillar of fire. This is the angel. Okay, what he is doing there? He had a little book open in his hand. You know what is that book? The book of the covenants that he has written. Okay? Many Bible commentators and theoretical commentators will tell you this angel is a kind of Jesus and this and that. That is not. This angel is the angel who records the covenants of God, which was there during the time of Noah when God made a covenant, which was there with Abraham and then executing that covenant for the people of Israel. Okay, you will see all those elements there: fire, cloud, rainbow. When Israel was rescued, there was cloud and fire. Those were the two legs there with the angel, the angel was standing. So he had a little book open in his hand, and he set his right foot on the sea and his left foot on the land, and cried with a loud voice as when a lion roars. When he cried out, seven thunders uttered their voices. Okay, let me skip that. Those are the revelation of seven thunders. It will confuse you a lot. Let us not go into that. But what happens is, what happens in verse 7 is, but in the days of the sounding of the seventh angel, when he is about to sound, the mystery of God would be finished, as he declared to his servants the prophets. Then the voice which I heard from heaven spoke to me again and said, go take the little book which is open in the hand of the angel who stands on the sea and on the earth. He is so huge that one leg is on the sea, one leg is on the earth. You see? Hallelujah. So I went to the angel and said to him, give me the little book. And he said to me, take and eat it, and it will make your stomach bitter, but it will be as sweet as honey in your mouth. Then I took the little book out of the angel's hand and ate it, and it was as sweet as honey in my mouth. But when I had eaten it, my stomach became bitter. And he said to me, you must prophesy again about many people, nations, tongues and kings. What he would prophesy? The book that he has eaten. What is the book contains? What does the book contains? The covenants of God. Prophesy the covenants of God. Prophesy the covenants of God that he made. That he made for nations, people, languages and kings. Prophesy the covenants of God. Do you see that? Okay. So, where I was in Noah. I was in Genesis about Noah. God made a covenant. Hallelujah. And at the end, this is one of the covenant that will be released for judgment against Satan. That God will not only destroy mankind, the whole mankind, but God will preserve the remnant and destroy Satan. That's why at the brightness of the coming of the Lord will capture the beast and the prophet. The beast is the Antichrist. The prophet is the second beast. I told you he is the second beast who advertises the Antichrist. Both of them will be taken alive and thrown into the lake of fire. And Satan will be caged for 1,000 years. And there will be 1,000 years of reign. And then after 1,000 years, Satan will be released and he will again gather the souls of people. So that is what the covenant was. Noah was. The covenant was, never again I will only punish mankind. But this time, in my punishment, in my judgment, this accuser who continues to accuse the brethren will be thrown into judgment. That is what Revelation chapter number 12 says. The accuser of the brethren was judged. Yes. Satan was escaping by only provoking the people to sin against God. And he knew whenever people sin against God, God will destroy them. So he was sitting on his chair, on his throne, and taking, enjoying the torment upon people. But this time God told Noah, I will never again destroy the mankind with this process where only men are destroyed. I will use the process of a mystery. That is what the Bible says here. At the sound of the seventh trumpet, the mystery was completed. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Are we understanding, people of God? So what I want to say is, that is how Satan provokes God's anger by making the people of the nations sin against God so that God can destroy the nation. So the covenant that God made with Noah was, I will never again use that process. So this time God will preserve his remnant, along with he will destroy the culprit in the lake of fire by the evidence that the chief lawyer Jesus Christ has produced. How will he bring about that judgment on the accuser? How? By the evidence that the chief lawyer. Who is the chief lawyer? Come on, someone. What? Yes. Jesus. Say loudly, Jesus.
Jesus.
What is the evidence the chief lawyer has produced? The evidence that he has produced that will put the accuser into judgment is in the book of Colossians. If you want to put someone, a death judgment on someone, you need to produce a evidence that is quite convincing enough to put that person to death. Right? Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. The evidence that the chief lawyer has produced is actually in the book of Colossians. Let me take you there. Book of Colossians, chapter number 2. Verse 14. Having wiped out the handwriting of requirements that was against us, which was contrary to us, and he has taken it out of the way, having nailed it to the cross. His body broken on the cross and his blood shed was the evidence he produced for the judgment to come upon Satan. Okay? Having disarmed principalities and powers, he made public spectacle of them, triumphing over them in it. Hallelujah. That is the evidence. He nailed every files that Satan brings on the cross. Everything nailed on the cross by the evidence of his broken body and the blood that was shed by the chief lawyer. He pleads the case for the nations. He pleads the case for his people who walk in the jurisdiction of his blood and of his word, that they cannot be destroyed by Satan. Hallelujah. Mako ramaka semoko riata raba. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. So, it's impossible now. It's impossible for a child of God to be defeated. Amen. Hallelujah. Because the evidence that will preserve you is been produced by the chief lawyer Jesus Christ. And the evidence is his broken body and his blood. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Okay. Let us go ahead. I don't have so much of time. Let me take you. What I was saying is that whenever you try to do ministry, the Satan will come against you with files to God in the court of heaven, and you will be hindered. That happened in the Bible. Let's go to Ezra chapter number 4. Hallelujah. Very important. Ezra chapter number 4. Let me read from verse number 1. Now when the adversaries of Judah and Benjamin heard that the descendants of the captivity were building the temple of the Lord God of Israel, so the descendants of Benjamin, the children of Israel, what they were doing? They started to do ministry. What is the ministry? Rebuilding the temple of God in Israel. When the adversaries saw that happening, what did they do? They came to Zerubbabel and the heads of the father's house and said to them, "Let us build with you, for we seek your God as you do, and we have sacrificed to him since the day of Eshadan, king of Assyria, who brought us here." But Zerubbabel and Jeshua, also called Joshua, okay, his name is also Joshua or Jeshua, and the rest of the heads of the father's houses of Israel said to them, "You may do nothing with us to build a house for our God, but we alone will build the Lord God of Israel, build to the Lord God of Israel as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, has commanded us." Then the people of the land tried to discourage the people of Judah. They troubled them in building and hired counselors against them to frustrate their purpose all the days of Cyrus, king of Persia, even until the reign of Darius, king of Persia. In the reign of Ahasuerus, in the beginning of his reign, they wrote an accusation, underline accusation. An accusation was written against who? Against the inhabitants of Judah and Jerusalem. Stop there. So Zerubbabel and Jeshua, the leaders who were building the house of God, the adversaries came first and tried to collaborate with them. We are also Christians. We will also do the work of God to corrupt the work of God by their filthy, corrupt, evil ideas. But they were discerning enough, the leaders. They were doing the work of the Lord quite good in the will of the Lord. And they said, "We will not let you in. We alone will build the house." When they saw that they are not able to penetrate in the church, they started to persecute the church. And they started to accuse them. And in the reign of Ahasuerus, they wrote an accusation against this people, that this people are dangerous and all those things. I don't have time to go there. But ultimately what happened in verse number 24 is, "Thus the work of the house of God which is at Jerusalem ceased, and it was discontinued until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia." They were trying to build the house of God, but Satan stopped them. How? By bringing, I will show you that scripture, by bringing accusation against a leader, that is Jeshua. Okay, now stay with me. Verse chapter number 5, Ezra chapter number 5. Then the prophet Haggai and Zechariah, the son of Edo, prophets prophesied to the Jews who were in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of the God of Israel who was over them. So Zerubbabel the son of Shealtiel and Jeshua the son of Jozadak rose up and began to build the house which is in Jerusalem, and the prophets of God were with them, helping them. Hallelujah. The prophets entered there and they prophesied. What did they prophesy? That the work of the temple started against the decree of the king, and they were not afraid to do that. What happened there? The prophet Zechariah visited the courtroom of heaven, and he pleaded the case for the leader Joshua, who was building the house, who has a good intention. Okay? And when the case against him was nullified, he came and prophesied. He told, "Start the work again and no accusations will come against you. Nothing will be able to stop you now because the courts of heaven has settled your case." Are we understanding? You are doing God's ministry and attacks and accusations coming against you. It's not about the people who are accusing you. There is something Satan is doing, bringing against you in the courts of heaven. Let me take you to show that in Zechariah chapter number 3. Hallelujah. Zechariah chapter number 3. Listen to this. Zechariah chapter number 3. Now prophets just don't come and prophesy like that. They have been with God, seen something, heard something. And that's why on the basis of that confirmation, they come and prophesy and say, "You go ahead and start the work of the Lord. I am prophesying to you. I know nothing will stop you because I was with God in the courts of heaven." That is what is written in Zechariah chapter number 3. Listen to it very carefully. Chapter number 3, verse number 1. Then he showed me Joshua the high priest. Showed to who? Zechariah. Then he showed me Joshua the high priest, the same person who was building the house of God, okay, who was hindered, standing before the angel of the Lord, and Satan standing at his right hand to oppose him in the courts of heaven. Joshua was standing, Satan was standing at the right hand of Joshua. That signifies that Satan had claims upon his life, had the authority over his life. That signifies that at the right hand of Joshua. And the Lord said to Satan, the Lord rebuke you, Satan. The Lord who has chosen Jerusalem rebuke you. Is this not a brand plucked from the fire? Now Joshua was clothed with filthy garments and was standing before the angel. Though he was a priest in the realms of the spirit, his garments were what? Filthy. Filthy. He was not in his identity in the realms of the spirit. Then he answered and spoke to those who stood before him, saying, take away the filthy garments from him. And to him he said, see, I have removed your iniquity from you, and I will clothe you with rich robes. Hallelujah. And I said, let them put a clean turban on his head. So they put a clean turban on his head. And they put the clothes on him, and the angel of the Lord stood by. Then the angel of the Lord admonished Joshua, saying, thus says the Lord of hosts, if you will walk in my ways, and if you will keep my command, then you shall also judge my house. Likewise, have charge of my courts. I will give you places to walk, and among these who stand here. Hallelujah. Joshua was accused, and that's why he was not able to minister here. The accusation that came here, actually the roots of it was from Satan, who was accusing Joshua to God. But Zechariah interceded, and he saw at last that he won the case, and he saw that Joshua's filthy garments were taken away, iniquities were taken away, his sins were taken away, that was holding him captive by Satan, and a new garment was given to him, a clean turban was given to him, by which now he can continue the work of the Lord. Taking this revelation, Zechariah the prophet, taking this revelation from the third heaven, he came and started to prophesy to the people of Israel. The case is cleared. Start the work, and Satan will not be able to stop you, because God has justified the leader of his people in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. And I want to intercede tonight that God will justify. Hallelujah. God will justify by the blood of Jesus Christ. Many people who are been hindered here by Satan, many people who are been hindered here, and you are been accused, you are been put in filth by Satan in the courtroom of heaven. I plead your case with the blood of Jesus Christ, which was shed for you. I plead your case with the broken body of Jesus that was sacrificed for your sin, for your curses. Hallelujah. For the curses that came from your father and your mother, every case that stand against you, you just have to repent of it, accept your sin, and it will be washed away by the blood of the Lamb. Hallelujah. Cases against people be nullified in the name of Jesus. Files that are opened be destroyed by fire in the name of Jesus. Handwriting and on ordinances written contrary to them be nailed on the cross in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Release the power, Lord, to deliver your people tonight in Jesus' mighty name. That many of your servants will be released right now in the name of Jesus Christ. The next thing I want to pray is every nation sitting here, whether it is Canada, whether it is United States, whether it is Kenya, India, Pakistan, hallelujah, British Virgin Island, whatever nation, Guyana, we pray, Nigeria, Africa, whichever representative of nation is sitting out in this place, sitting in this place, that you shall become lawyers in the courtroom of heaven. I pray there is a lack, of representatives. Oh, who can represent the nations, and that's why the nations are suffering. Oh Lord, raise up representatives, raise up those intercessors, raise up those watchmen who can stand as lawyers. Equip them with the revelation of the Spirit of God. Equip them with the revelation of the judicial laws of heaven. Equip them with the wisdom of how they should plead the case and cancel the claims of the devil that he brings against the people of God, that he brings against the nations. Raise up lawyers in the name of Jesus Christ. Raise up spiritual lawyers in the name of Jesus Christ. Prabala, this is the rise of the watchmen. This is the rise of the prophets of God, the real prophets of God, who will be able to plead the cases of nations. Hallelujah. Rebo Shabra Tikera Mala. Em Pribele Hal Sial Sarabrabala. Lahal Sarabrabala Hal Sarabroboti Alaba. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you for your mighty word. Oh, thank you for your utterance that is there in our midst, O Lord. Hallelujah. We give you the praise, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Lesial Sembri Al Tiara Brabala. Lord, I pray. The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. And the laborers that God is calling is not for the field. The laborers that He is calling is to rise high in the levels of heaven and to seek the Lord, to seek the Lord. He is looking not for ministers, He is looking for seekers who can stand to represent nations in the courtroom of heaven. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ. Oh Lord, hallelujah, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. The presence of God is here, and the Lord is doing a mighty work in your life, brethren. Mighty work He is doing. If you are here, you are a part of a revival that the world has never seen. If you are here listening to me and you are able to bear the words that I spoke and receive the words, you are a part of a season. Yes, surely you are a part of a season on the face of the earth. Hallelujah, that the world has never seen. Hallelujah, you shall manifest the Lord Most High to principalities, to powers, to kings, to rulers of darkness. You will be the instrument used to manifest the character of God, the power of God, the wisdom of God. Hallelujah. Le prakachara balaba. Satan will be afraid of you. Satan will be insecure about you. Satan will hate you. Satan will want to kill you. Yet he can do nothing to you. He will not be able to do nothing to you. Hallelujah. For you are a lawyer for God. Hallelujah. Labari karparasa. Ram prakhala barabrovala. Halsi al sarabantra. Hallelujah. 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 The Lord would never let Elijah be killed. He come what may, He will send angels, He will send protection and preserve Elijah. Because Elijah is important in the kingdom of God. Has your value in the kingdom of God rose high, that God cannot lose you? If God is in a mindset that I cannot lose this man, extra protection, anointing and everything God will invest on you. His anointing, His power, His wisdom, the Lord will invest on you to protect you from harm. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah. A generation of watchmen are rising here in the name of Jesus Christ. A generation, a new breed of the Spirit. A new breed of the Spirit is rising in the name of Jesus Christ. Who will prophesy not from the first or second heaven. Who will prophesy accurate voice of God, Lord. Lord, like Zechariah and Haggai. Lord, they came and they restarted the work of the church there. By the prophetic ministry, by the watchmen and intercession ministry they were in. They restarted the work of the church in Jesus' mighty name. Satan, who has stopped the work of God in nations, in villages, in cities, Satan, who has held captive the servants of God, I prophesy to you that you are released in Jesus' mighty name. Hallelujah. The work will start again in the name of Jesus Christ. Reboko ramake yala. I pray that you will equip people with your wisdom and knowledge, that they will be able to fight, plead, and win the case against the accuser. in the name of Jesus. Father, I give you all the glory, honor and praise. I cover everyone, all their families with the blood of Jesus who are here, Lord, and who are not able to attend, Lord. Cover all of them with the blood of Jesus. And we give you all the glory, honor and praise in Jesus' mighty name. We pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Can we shout amen? Hallelujah.
Amen.
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 Amen. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Glory
to God.
Thank you.
Thank you, Pastor
Rahul. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Hallelujah.
Worship some good food. Glory. Worship God.
Amen. Amen.
Glory.
Okay, so we want to thank God, and he will announce tomorrow's intercession again service, which is the core of our ministry. Okay, and yes. Sunday we will have service evening 8:00, and so we will send you the links and the invites for those things to tomorrow. Mm-hmm. Sister K will announce Sunday we have 8 p.m. the service, and God bless you all. Stay blessed. Over to Sister K.
Oh, amen. Thank you very much, Apostle Rahul. Oh my God, this is amazing teaching, and it's deep teaching of the Word. And I love this Watchman series, because I was watching the last tape you sent on the tour, part 3, with King Jehoshaphat. When he listened to a true prophet, Micaiah, or what his name was, that went to the third heaven. Now I'm learning about the third heaven with the angels, the host of angels. He brought that message down, but the wicked King Ahab trusted his 400 prophets who only heard from the second heaven. No wonder he was destroyed when he went into to conquer that city. You know, it is such good teaching that we're listening here to that I never knew about. And this is much more than we ever thought. So I just want to remind people, come out, let's pray now that we're getting such insight into this intercessor and this Watchman series. It is priceless. And I want to say hello to my nephew, Ajay, from Guyana. He's on tonight. Hi, Ajay. Welcome. I'm so glad that you're back online here so you can hear these very, very cutting edge teaching. Okay, you want to say hello to anyone? Thank you, God.
I've been off for a while. I needed some time out. But when God is ready to set you back on track, nothing that you think you know can work unless God says yes. I came on here tonight with a request from God. Because on the 26th of March, I am going to restart our church that we once had where I live. And I'm asking God if this is the right time, if it's the right thing to do. Tell me what you want me to do. And moments ago, I just got me my answer.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
People of God, keep on holding on to the Lord. No matter how tough it seems to be, hold on. He will come true for you. God bless you.
Back to root.
Amen.
I just want to welcome everybody in the Zoom tonight. And at this time, we would like all of us to join in prayer and pray for Sister Pushpa. She's on the line tonight. And I think Dr. John needed prayer. And everyone that needed prayer today, we're going to just join together and agree in praying for prayer for
hallelujah.
For everyone that's on the line that need prayer tonight. And Sister K, could you lead them in prayer?
I was going to ask Apostle Rahul, but thank you, Jesus. We can pray. You know, by his stripes, we are healed.
Yes, God.
We're God's children, and we are saved. We are washed in the blood. And when we took Christ as our Savior and accept Him in our heart. Salvation came with a package, and in that package is healing. Father, I thank you, God, that, Lord, you will speak to these individuals, Lord Jesus, that are sick tonight, and let them know that you care for them, and by your stripe they are healed. Let them accept their healing and walk into their healing, oh God.
Yes, God.
Healing is the cheering bread. You send your word and heal it.
Yes, God.
And touch them in the name of Jesus, God.
Yes, God.
Father, and let them go rejoicing, oh God. Let's hear testimony on this line, Father God. We thank you in the name of Jesus.
Thank you, God. Thank you.
Tomorrow at 7:30, I forget to mention, it's prayer meeting. So come on, all you watchmen and intercessors.
Amen.
Thank you.
Sunday night, we're having a from prayer meeting at 8 o'clock with Pastor Rahul on Sunday. So everyone is invited, and invite someone. We all are watchmen, so we have to go out there and evangelize and win the people for God. At this time, with Latanya, if you have anything you would like to say.
Good evening, saints of God. Great grace. I just, like Sister Kate, the teaching was awesome. You're taking us higher and higher. And truly, we're having access to the throne room just through your teaching, Pastor Rahul. And like I always say, it was a scrumptious meal. We need to be encouraged, and let's encourage one another. And I believe every word. You always reference it to scripture. Anybody ask me, why do you? I said, because he's a man of God, and he takes us to the scripture. It's right there in the book. And for that, I am truly grateful. God bless you, Apostle Rahul, and each and every one of you. Great grace.
Amen. But Wandry, you have something to say?
I just want to thank God that it's now raining. We prayed for the rain last time, and in our country we are experiencing rains, and we thank God for that. But in darkness, there's no electricity, so I thank God too. Thank you.
Amen. Sister Pushpa, do you want to say something? I don't know if she's there. Sister Pushpa, are you there?
Yeah, yes. Sister Ruth, God bless. God bless everyone. God is so awesome. God is so good to me, you know. So I'm so thankful to him that I'm alive and well, and he has given me another day to go on, you know. I keep going due to the strength of God and your prayer, saints. Thank you so much, and God bless all of you. In Jesus' mighty name. The message was powerful, and we should continue with that, because God loves us so much that he brought Pastor Rahul to us so we can gain some knowledge and go further in that. Never give up. Stand and go on. Thank you, and God bless.
Amen. It's good to hear from you. Good to have you on tonight. At this time, I think, Brother Lindsay, are you ready to blow the shofar?
Yes.
Is Aaron at home now?
He is home. Yes, he is. He is home. He's on some type of antibiotic machine for the next 10 days up. No, let's see. For the next 12 days, I believe. No, I'm trying to think. I know he's on it for 11 days, but I can't remember how many days he got left, but I think he had about 12 more days left. But he preached yesterday at the bridal conference. Deborah asked him to preach, and he did a good job. He's lost 33 pounds.
Wow.
Yeah. So just keep him in your prayers.
We have.
Hallelujah. Well, let everyone just receive the shofar blessing. Baruch Atah Adonai, Eloheinu Melech HaOlam. Asher Kiddushanu, V'mitzvato Vetivanu, Lishmo Kol Shofar. Blessed are you, Lord our God, Master of the universe, who sanctifies us with your commandments and commands us to hear the sound of the shofar.
Amen.
Amen.
Well, we will see everyone tomorrow night at 7:30, and on Sunday, Pastor Rahul, we're having a prayer meeting at 8 o'clock. At this time, I would like to ask Sister Miriam if she could end the service in prayer.
Sure. Thank you, Sister Ruth. Abba Father, we come into your holy presence to praise you and to thank you for your word. Thank you, Father God, in Jesus' name, for the awesome teaching that we received, for your wrenching word that cut us spirit and soul. We just ask you, Father God, to let those words dwell in our spirit and take complete stability of our body, mind, soul, and spirit as we go into the world to do what you command. In Jesus' most holy and precious name, amen.
Amen. Good night.
Good night.